How to Solve a Crime. Real Cases from the Cutting Edge of Forensics by Angela Gallop and Jane Smith. Read by Sandra Duncan. Introduction. A man runs down a dark alleyway, the sound of his footsteps echoing from the damp stone walls. As the camera pulls in, we can see blood on his hands and on the front of his hooded jacket. Most of his face is hidden. But as he emerges from the shadows onto the dimly lit street, he turns his head, and we catch a glimpse of what appear to be three scratch marks on his left cheek. Cut to a forensic laboratory, where a scientist has just matched the sole of a trainer seized from a suspect's flat with the bloody footwear marks she had lifted earlier that morning from the floor of the kitchen where the terrible crime took place. "If I can get a DNA sample from the scrapings taken from under the victim's fingernails," she says, focusing the microscope with her own slender fingers, "we might be able to identify the murderer before the end of the day." Typical scenes, perhaps, from one of the many fictionalised versions of forensic science that feature in some entertaining programmes on TV. But I think that real forensics is much more interesting, and I hope that after hearing this book, you'll tend to agree. My first book, When the Dogs Don't Bark, told the story of my professional career, initially as a forensic biologist with the Home Office Forensic Science Service, and then as a founder or co-founder of forensic companies, when I also specialised particularly in cold case investigations. During those years, I have been privileged to work with some of the most talented and inspirational forensic scientists in the UK. And How to Solve a Crime considers a much broader range of forensic expertise, as I have tried to tell aspects of their stories mixed with my own experiences in an effort to present forensic science in its true light. Because forensics can involve anything and everything encountered in everyday life, attempting to cover every aspect of it would be a very tall order. So I have tried instead to give a flavour of its richness and variety, and to counteract the notion that it is all about crime scene investigation, or CSI. It's true that the crime scene is where most forensic science begins, but although CSI is certainly very important, it generally constitutes only part of the job of a forensic scientist. The next stage in the process takes place in the laboratory, where items and samples from the crime scene and elsewhere are examined and tested, and the results are evaluated in the context of the specific circumstances of the case in hand. This in turn usually leads to the courtroom, where these results are presented as evidence for the judge and jury to consider. While writing this book, I was aware that it mustn't end up being less about how to solve than how to get away with crime. Another thought that kept coming to the forefront of my mind was that there are two main things preventing us today from being able to solve virtually every crime. The first is error due to inexperience or lack of appropriate forensic skills. The second is the lack of sufficient funds being spent on collecting and investigating the evidence that is there somewhere, just waiting to be found. Smash-and-grab forensics is no way to get to the bottom of a really complex case. Rather, it requires a combination of innovative approaches, laser-like observation, and testing carried out with surgical precision by dedicated and experienced forensic scientists to help to identify and convict the guilty and exonerate the innocent. Indeed, the contribution forensic science can make to the delivery of justice would be beyond the wildest imaginings of French criminologist Edmond Locard when he developed his principle of every contact leaves a trace more than 100 years ago. But he was spot on, as we have been able to prove time and time again. Another reality that might not be apparent from watching TV programmes is that forensic scientists often don't know the outcomes of the cases they work on. This is because some of the many cases we deal with don't go to court until months, even years later, and we are not always called to give evidence when they do. Also, for someone to be convicted of a crime, it is usually necessary to have more than one type of evidence to link them with it. But I hope that the cases and details I have included at least give an idea of what forensic scientists actually do, and why they find the work so satisfying, most of the time. Chapter 1. What insects can tell us about crime? One day, the fully clothed body of a farmer was found at the side of a road. The numerous wounds on his head appeared to have been inflicted with a sickle, and it was thought at first that he had been killed during the course of a robbery. But when it became apparent that no personal effects were missing from the body, the farmer's wife was questioned about any possible enemies he might have had. Although there were none that she could think of, she did give the investigator the name of a man who had recently asked to borrow money from her husband but didn't get it. Then the investigator, a man called Zung Zhu, gathered together the men of the village and told them to place their sickles on the ground in front of them. It was a hot day, and Zung Zhu waited and watched as flies began to alight on just one of the 70 or more curved-bladed implements. The killing of the farmer occurred in rural China in the 13th century, and the murder, which was described in a book entitled The Washing Away of Wrongs, written by Zung Zhu and printed in 1247, is generally recognised as being the first recorded case to involve forensic entomology. Zung Zhu might not have been aware at the time that flies and other insects have sensory cells on their antennae that give them an acute sense of smell and enable them to detect the odour of a body within minutes of death. What he obviously did know, however, was that the flies would be attracted to traces of blood on the sickle that had been used by the killer. And when faced with the evidence, the man who had tried to borrow money from the deceased farmer confessed to his murder. From Greek mythology to the Renaissance paintings of the 15th century, flies have long been a symbol of death, the devil, and decay. People have also been aware for many years of the value of information provided by insects in the forensic context. But it wasn't until the mid-1800s that insects began to be associated with murder in the West. What is known today as forensic entomology is the study of insects and other invertebrate animals that are found on or around decomposing bodies, or in other locations where these have been. One of the first forensic entomologists in Europe was a French physician called Louis Bergeret, who performed an autopsy in 1850 on the mummified body of a baby that had been found behind a fireplace in a flat. What Bergeret discovered in several cavities of the baby's body were numerous empty larval skins, known as puparia, and cast off by pupa as they metamorphose to become adults of the flesh fly species, Musca carnaria. It was likely that the eggs from which the larvae had emerged had been laid shortly after death, and that the adults of this particular species would have developed the following year. Taking those facts into account, together with the natural history of the clothes moth larvae that had also infested the mummified body, Bergeret concluded that death had occurred 2 years before it was found. It turned out that four families had rented the flat during the previous 3 years, and after three of them had been eliminated as suspects, one couple was arrested and ultimately convicted of the child's murder. Forensic entomology is often used today to help estimate the time since death, also known as the post-mortem interval, or PMI. What is actually being estimated is the time since colonisation by the insects, and as this will have occurred after death itself, when the body started to decompose, it provides only a minimum PMI. But when considered in conjunction with the maximum time since death, which is based on when the person was last seen alive, an estimate can be made of the window of time within which that person must have died. The development of insects that metamorphose includes four distinct phases: egg, larva, called a maggot when the larva is a housefly or similar species, pupa, and adult. If a body is outside and easily accessible, flies and other insects attracted by the smell will arrive in a sequence that reflects the state of decomposition. Each phase of insect development is also temperature dependent, so it is possible to gauge the time since death by examining the stage of development of specific types of insects on a corpse and ascertaining from meteorological records, where necessary, the prevailing temperature when the insects developed. One of the first recorded cases in the UK to have been solved on the basis of forensic entomology involved the murder of two women in 1935. When the remains of the women's bodies were found near a stream in a ravine in Dumfriesshire in Scotland, they were identified as Isabella Kerr and Mary Rogerson. Isabella was the wife of a respected doctor called Buck Ruxton. Mary was their maid at their home in Lancaster, where the couple lived with their three children. Maggots that were collected from the women's remains were examined at a laboratory at the University of Edinburgh, where they were identified as being between 12 and 14 days old and from the blowfly species. Having established that the bodies must have been in the location in which they were found for at least that length of time, suspicion fell on Dr. Ruxton. The evidence that seemed to implicate the doctor in the deaths of the two women included the skillful way in which the bodies had been dismembered, which might have been accounted for by his knowledge of anatomy. Also, the woman who cleaned the couple's house reported the presence of bloodstains and a horrible smell at the relevant time, and that the doctor had had a cut on his hand. And although the bodies were found in Dumfriesshire, about 100 miles away from their home in Lancaster, parts of them were wrapped in an edition of a newspaper that was only circulated in the Lancaster area. In the end, the evidence against Ruxton was overwhelming, and after being found guilty of murdering Isabella and Mary, he was hanged in 1936. Forensic entomology can sometimes also provide an insight into the cause of death, the way in which someone died, and possibly the geographical area in which a body was kept before it was discovered. If a body has been moved, a forensic entomologist may be able to identify from the species of insects present where it was when the processes of decomposition and colonization began. The introduction of DNA profiling in the late 1980s provided another potentially reliable and durable source of insect-related forensic evidence, as the human DNA ingested by fly larvae when they feed off a decomposing cadaver can even be found in puparia. And 70 years after the murders of Isabella Kerr and Mary Rogerson, it was entomological evidence from puparia and dead flies that helped to identify the killer of 27-year-old mother of three, Chantelle Taylor. Just over a year after Chantelle had been reported missing from her home in Birkenhead in April 2004, there was an arson attack on a mosque in the town. DNA on clothing found near the mosque gave a match on the National DNA database to a local man called Stephen Wynne. When arrested, Wynne admitted to a charge of arson, and it was during a subsequent search of his house that a poem was discovered which mentioned a junkie whore ending up dead, and DNA evidence waiting to be found. The original police investigation into the death of Chantelle Taylor had highlighted her violent partner as the only credible suspect. But when Wynne was questioned about the poem, he admitted to having murdered Chantelle with a cleaver. According to Wynne, he had picked Chantelle up on the day she went missing and taken her to his home, where they had drunk alcohol, smoked cannabis and snorted cocaine. The next thing he remembered was coming round to find himself lying on the bathroom floor, surrounded by and covered from head to toe with blood. The cleaver and Chantelle's severed head and arms were lying beside her body in the bath, but Wynne claimed to have no memory of attacking her. What he did remember, however, was transferring the unwrapped body parts to an old water tank in the loft. He had then put his clothing and Chantelle's in two bin bags in the backyard of his house, together with a block of concrete, in which he said he had encased the cleaver, before scrubbing the bathroom with bleach and cleaning and painting the main bedroom. According to Wynne, 2 weeks after he had killed Chantelle, he took her body parts out of the loft and disposed of them at several sites in the surrounding Wirral Peninsula. But although they were never found at the sites he identified, the bin bags and concrete block were discovered in his backyard, as he described. The fact that Chantelle had had a previous run-in with the law meant that her DNA profile was on the National DNA database, And when a DNA profile obtained from the blood on two extensively blood-stained shirts found in the bin bags was loaded onto the database, it was found to be a match for her. Although Stephen Wynne was the primary suspect, his version of events still needed to be corroborated, or refuted, by solid evidence. So forensic investigators conducted a detailed examination of his house. If his claim was true, and he had carried Chantelle's dismembered and unwrapped body from the bath to the loft, it was extremely unlikely that even rigorous and repeated cleaning would have removed every last trace of blood. And although there was no visible blood in the bathroom, when the carpet was pulled up and the bath panel removed, chemical screening tests gave a positive reaction for blood, which DNA analysis showed to be a match for Wynne himself. There were no visible blood stains in the bedroom either. But again, when the carpet was lifted, blood was found on the floorboards and on the wooden joists beneath them, which DNA testing showed this time to be a match for Chantelle. No blood or body tissue was either visible or detected by chemical screening anywhere in the loft, where Wynne claimed he had kept the body before disposing of it. What the scientists did discover, however, were numerous adult flies and empty puparia on the floor, as well as hundreds more puparia under the plastic sheeting that covered a disused water tank. Back at the laboratory, forensic entomologist Dr. Samantha Pickles identified the pupae, puparia and adult flies as belonging to a species of flesh flies, blowflies, houseflies, lesser houseflies and scuttleflies. Taking into account their presence in such large numbers and in such a variety of species, together with the fact that the pupae would have continued to develop to adults after their source of food had been removed, it seemed likely that the infestation had occurred and ended in the loft. This meant that it was also likely that the body parts, if indeed that was what the insects had been feeding off, had been there for some time. Toxicological testing of the puparia, led by Dr. Alex Allen, revealed the presence of the heroin metabolite morphine, which suggested that the larvae had either fed on or passed through some substance that contained it. The fact that Chantelle was known to have been a heroin addict added some significance to this finding. Also, DNA profiling from the puparia detected some DNA components that matched hers, as well as some that did not. So although the number of DNA contributors could not be established, it was possible that Chantelle was one of them. Meanwhile, the concrete block from Wynne's backyard had been broken open and found to contain a cleaver, saw blade and kitchen knife, none of which had any traces of blood, flesh, hair or textile fibres on them. And although DNA was found on the cleaver, it was not possible to confirm that any of it had come from the suspect or the victim. However, some blood spots on bedding found in the bin bags did provide a DNA match with Chantelle, as did the DNA profile obtained from some fragments of bone, whose appearance indicated that they were likely to be human. There was nothing to implicate the original suspect, Chantelle's apparently violent partner, in her killing and the disposal of her body. By contrast, various strands of the forensic evidence suggested that she could have been in the bedroom at Wynne's house and that her body could have been stored in the loft there for a period of time. But while some aspects of the evidence supported Wynne's version of events, there was nothing to support his claim that Chantelle had been in the bath, bleeding heavily, before being transferred to the loft, unwrapped and dripping blood. In the end, though, when Stephen Wynne appeared before a judge at Liverpool Crown Court in January 2006, he unexpectedly pleaded guilty to the murder. With his memory having apparently been restored, Wynne claimed that he and Chantelle had shared drugs and alcohol before having sex in his bedroom. Then, on noticing that a bag of heroin had gone missing, and seeing it partially concealed under the top Chantelle was wearing, an altercation had occurred during which he struck her neck with a cleaver. Bleeding heavily, Chantelle had fallen on the floor at the foot of the bed. This is where, according to Wynne, he had left her for some time before dismembering her body and transferring the various body parts to the loft, where they remained until he disposed of them elsewhere. Following a trial, and in the absence of a body which has still not been found, Stephen Wynne was convicted of the murder of Chantelle Taylor and sentenced to life in prison. Insects have long been used to indicate time since death, but as with so many other tools in the forensic scientist's armoury, they can sometimes provide much more subtle information. When a body has been moved, for example, or even, as in the case of Chantelle Taylor, when a crime is suspected for some reason, but no body has been found. Chapter 2. No body, no crime? Contrary to what some people might believe, absence of a body does not equate to absence of evidence. So although absence of a body can certainly be a complicating factor in cases of suspected murder, it is often still possible to convict or acquit a particular suspect, as happened when a doctor called Hassan al-Shatanawi was accused of murdering his wife in 1993. Laura al-Shatanawi had been missing from the couple's home in County Durham for more than 3 weeks by the time her husband went to the police. The reason he hadn't been unduly worried at first, he explained, was because he assumed she had gone on a trip she had been talking about taking. I don't know whether the police already considered al-Shatanawi to be a suspect in his wife's disappearance before he appeared on television to plead with her to come home. But they must certainly have done so after someone responded to the TV appeal, saying that Hassan al-Shatanawi had paid him £10 to burn a virtually new shed. Apparently the shed had only very recently been erected on al-Shatanawi's allotment, and fortuitously, as it turned out, instead of burning it as instructed, the man who contacted the police had actually sold it to a friend. When scenes of crime officers and forensic scientists examined the shed, they found that an area of the surface of the floor, measuring approximately 3 by 2 feet, appeared to have been cut or gouged away with a chisel or similar tool. Even more interesting were some small stains discovered on the edges of some of the floorboards in the damaged area, which tests proved to be blood mixed with or possibly overlain by a creosote-like wood preservative. At first, traditional blood grouping tests carried out at the Home Office Forensic Science Service, the FSS laboratory at Wetherby, indicated that the blood in the shed could have come from Hassan al-Shatanawi himself. However, this possibility was subsequently ruled out by DNA tests. At that time, 1993, the two types of test were often used in parallel until DNA took over completely. With Laura still missing, there were no samples of her blood available for analysis, but her medical records showed that she belonged to Group B in the ABO blood grouping system. This information, together with analysis of blood from her father, brother and son, indicated that the blood in the shed could have been hers. Tests that were carried out on the saliva on the back of a stamp affixed to a postcard that Laura had sent to her parents while she was on holiday in Malta some years earlier indicated that the blood in the shed could have come from the person who had licked the stamp. But when saliva from where the stamp had been on another envelope sent by Laura a year later was tested, the results were different. It could have been her son's, but it could not have come from the same person whose blood was in the shed. So either Hassan had licked the stamp for Laura, or the blood on the floorboards wasn't hers at all. After being employed by Hassan's defence solicitor, I visited the laboratory at Wetherby to examine some of the evidence. Having previously worked at the lab myself, I knew the scientists there very well, but checking their work on behalf of the defence was slightly different from working with them. In my early days as a defence expert, and before my colleagues and I became used to my rather different role, it used to feel like doing two jobs at once. One of those jobs was all about putting the scientists who conducted the original work at their ease and reassuring them that I wasn't there to try to catch them out. The other involved reviewing the detail of what they'd done and found so that I could work out what it might mean in terms of the case against the defendant and advise the solicitor accordingly. One of the things I did while I was at the laboratory in Wetherby on that occasion was to stack the floorboards that had been removed from the shed in the same order they had been in while on the shed floor, to get an idea of the distribution of the blood on them. What I discovered was that some of the stains on the edge of one floorboard corresponded to those on its neighbour. These seemed to confirm that the blood had dripped between the two floorboards after the floor had been assembled, and that there had originally been substantial quantities of blood on their upper surfaces. Again, though, without authentic reference samples, it wasn't possible to say how likely it was that the blood was Laura's. None of the numerous tools that had been taken from the couple's house and tested during the original investigation could have been the chisel or similar implement that had been used to remove the surface of the floorboards. And although four human hairs recovered from the floor of the shed were generally similar in colour and microscopic appearance to hairs taken from Laura's hairbrush, they provided only a weak link with her in particular. When the case went to court, the evidence against Hassan al-Shatanawi included the hairs and the relatively large amount of blood that could have come from his wife and was found on the floor of the shed he owned at the time of her disappearance. On the other side of the argument were concerns about the lack of proper reference samples from Laura, the quality of some of the DNA results, and the statistical treatment of others. Apparently, however, the former outweighed the latter, and after being found guilty of murder, Hassan al-Shatanawi was sentenced to life in prison. Laura's body has never been found. It was forensic anthropology that helped to solve a case of suspected murder that occurred in 2004, when the only part of the victim's body that was found was a single fragment of bone. When 55-year-old Margaret Gardner's husband, John, reported his wife missing to the police, he claimed that the last time he had seen her was before she left their home in Helensburgh in Scotland to travel to London to visit their children. Following his arrest shortly afterwards, John Gardner told his daughter part of the story of what had happened before providing a statement to the police. What Gardner claimed was that he and his wife had argued while she was making a sandwich at lunchtime. When she turned on him during their altercation, he thought she was holding a knife in her hand, so he pushed her and she fell down the kitchen steps, hitting her head in the process. Realising that she was dead, Gardner wrapped her body in a towel and put it in the bath, which is where it remained until around 2 o'clock in the morning, when he transferred it to a polythene sheet, drove to a bridge in Dumbarton and dropped it in the River Leven. Then he drove home, washed out the bath, cleaned the polythene sheet and threw it in the bin, and washed the towel and his own bloodstained clothing in the washing machine. No body nor any human remains was found in the river when it was dredged and searched by divers. And according to an expert in coastal oceanography, it was likely to have become trapped in the dense marshes at the river estuary. When the couple's house was examined by forensic scientists, they found evidence of blood and a fragment of a tooth in the waste pipe of the bath. But it was a fragment of bone retrieved from the filter section of the washing machine that proved to be the key evidence. Leading anthropologist Professor Sue Black was able to identify the fragment of bone as coming from a specific area of the sphenoid bone from a human skull. When it was examined by pathologist Dr. Marjorie Turner, she made the point that it indicated a forceful injury, and when DNA was extracted from it, it proved to match Margaret Gardner's DNA. In September 2005, John Gardner was found guilty of culpable homicide and to perverting the course of justice by hiding his wife's body. He was sentenced to 6 years in prison for each offence, subsequently reduced on appeal to a total of 9 years, and was released in 2011. When the body of a murder victim is found, there is always some type of evidence on it. Some of this will be clearly visible, such as wounds inflicted by knives, guns, blunt instruments or ligatures. Some of it may be more difficult to visualise, or even invisible to the naked eye, such as textile fibres, hairs and traces of body fluids, from which DNA profiles can potentially be obtained. Sometimes, though, when no body has been found, and there is apparently only circumstantial evidence to indicate that a crime has taken place, other types of evidence have to be looked for, and other specialisms of forensic science may become involved in the investigation. As the cases described illustrate, however, it would be a mistake for anyone who has committed a murder to think that disposing of the body will destroy all the evidence that could be used to identify them. Chapter 3. Blood. Patterns and Trails. It was my first day in my first job, and I'd arrived early at the FSS facility in Harrogate, where I would be working as a higher scientific officer. After being shown upstairs to the biology laboratories in what used to be a large suburban house, I was sitting on a stool waiting for someone else to turn up when I noticed some blood-stained items of clothing hanging from a washing line that was suspended across one corner of the room. It was 1974, and there were few health and safety regulations in place. In fact, my own blood now runs cold when I think about the risks we took in those relatively early years, when testing for blood and semen, for example, involved using chemicals in the open laboratory that were subsequently proved to be carcinogenic. Or the distinctive taste of iron, as puffs of blood dust were scattered into the air whenever we examined heavily blood-stained items. Later on, the drying of clothing, bedding, etc., began to be restricted to fume cupboards. But although it was definitely a step in the right direction, these weren't really large enough to do an efficient job, and we ended up building proper drying rooms into the new laboratories we moved into at Wetherby in 1977, when the FSS labs in Harrogate and Newcastle were merged. The rise in the use of forensic science that occurred during the 1970s was a reflection of advances in technology, and the Home Office was investing large sums of money in new laboratories and employing more scientists. That expenditure was reduced a bit when subsequent labs were built at Huntingdon and Chepstow. But no expense was spared for that first new lab at Wetherby, which had wide corridors and even a bar. In fact, most of the labs had bars in those days. I thought it was very odd at the time, and it seems even odder when I look back on it with today's perspective. I remained at Wetherby until 1981, then moved to the FSS lab at Aldermaston, which is where I worked until I left the FSS altogether in 1985 to set up my own company. I was married to a fellow forensic scientist by that time, and my husband eventually joined me at the new company, which I called Forensic Access. But for the first 18 months, I worked alone in a small room in our house in Newbury in Berkshire. It was in the very early days of DNA profiling, so I didn't need any of the high-tech equipment that would become necessary a few years later. In any event, my new role mostly involved checking the work of others, which meant that the emphasis was firmly on review rather than primary analysis. So I simply converted a room into an office, bought a reconditioned comparison microscope, some electrophoresis equipment, a small fridge for the chemicals I needed in order to do a bit of blood grouping and textile fibre analysis, and a state-of-the-art, at the time, BBC master home computer. The reason I started Forensic Access was to try to redress the balance, which at that time was tipped very firmly in favour of the prosecution in almost all criminal cases, by providing second opinion forensic services for the defence. So once my own home office was set up, I started looking for clients. One of the ways in which we linked suspects to crimes in those days was by using the presence of various forms of the same chemical substances in the blood, in the process known as blood grouping. Each blood group system had advantages and disadvantages. For example, the ABO system was based on different antigens, and although it was relatively undiscriminating, it could be used with saliva and semen as well as blood itself, and lasted quite a long time after the body fluid had been shed. The PGM system, on the other hand, was based on different forms of the enzyme phosphoglucomutase, It was much more discriminating than ABO and also worked on semen, but only lasted for about 6 weeks. Today, it is the DNA in blood and other body fluids and tissues that makes it potentially useful in solving crime. And since DNA profiling became a regular tool in the forensic scientist's armory in the late 1980s, early 1990s, the techniques involved have become increasingly sophisticated. With blood grouping, it was usually only possible to say at best that there was a one in a few thousand chance of a particular blood sample having come from someone other than the suspect or victim. With DNA profiling, that chance will be near a one in a billion, which makes blood a more powerful form of evidence than ever. However, DNA is only half the story. It can tell you from whom the blood, semen or saliva, etc., could or could not have come, sometimes with a high degree of certainty. But it can't tell you anything about the sort of activity that gave rise to it. For this, you need to analyse the patterns, the blood-staining forms. Blood pattern analysis can also be useful, for example, if there are two or more conflicting explanations of an incident, when it can sometimes help to indicate which version of events is more likely to be true. In one case I became involved with at the request of the defendant's solicitor, it was alleged by the prosecution that John Barclay had carried out a severe and sustained assault on Patrick Lewis in a street in London, during which he had stamped repeatedly on Lewis's head and neck. The defendant admitted to having been involved in a fight, but claimed merely to have been defending himself after Lewis had sprayed him in the face with CS gas. And although Barclay denied having stamped on Lewis, he did admit to pushing him to the ground with his right foot to prevent the alleged victim renewing his attack on him. When the case was examined at the Metropolitan Police Forensic Science Laboratory, or MPFSL, the scientist focused on examining Barclay's clothing for any blood that could have come from Lewis. Her findings included three areas of blood staining on the uppers and sole of Barclay's right shoe, as well as some small spots and splashes of blood on the front of it, which tests showed could have come from Lewis, but not from Barclay himself. The distribution of the blood was reported as being strongly indicative of the wearer stamping on a heavily blood-stained surface. When I visited the MPFSL to speak to the scientist and examine the items myself, I found several types of bloodstain as reported. Also, the bloodstaining on Barclay's right shoe included the most important characteristic elements of stamping into wet blood. So if Barclay's claim was true, and he had knocked Lewis to the ground by pushing him in the chest with his foot, the bloodstaining could only be explained if Lewis's clothing had been sodden with blood at the time. One might also expect Lewis to have sustained some injury from the force of the blow. There is no means of establishing how many times such stamping would have to have occurred to account for the bloodstaining on Barclay's clothes. There must have been a minimum of two blows, however. The first to break the skin and start the blood flow, and the second, and any subsequent blows, to splash and spatter blood onto the shoe. So it was difficult to see how such a pattern could have been produced merely by Barclay pushing Lewis to the ground with his foot. Therefore, on this occasion, rather than being able to provide any additional insights for Barclay's legal team to use in his defence, my observations appeared to be more supportive of the prosecution's case. But at least the defence team knew where they were. In conjunction with the injuries a victim has sustained, blood pattern analysis can provide the scientist with an idea of what happened at a crime scene, and in some cases with quite a detailed sequence of events. In particularly violent cases, it can also indicate whether any of the blood might alternatively have come from an offender, which is a very useful starting point for obtaining their DNA profile from which they might then be identified. Blood patterns are formed whenever blood is spilled, and it is the nature and distribution of the different elements of such a pattern that are important. For instance, smears and smudges of blood result from contact between two surfaces, at least one of which has some wet blood staining on it. If the staining is in the form of a print, It may tell you that it has been made by a blood-stained finger, or the sole of a shoe, for example. Sometimes there is also a directional component to the appearance of a smear. Splashed or spattered stains, as in the case described, arise when wet blood is subjected to some sort of force that causes it to split up into droplets and fan out away from the point at which the force was applied. The greater the speed of impact, the smaller are the individual droplets of blood produced. For example, the blood pattern resulting from being stabbed with a knife or shaking blood-covered hands will look very different from that due to being struck with a fist or hammer, which is different again from that resulting from having been shot with a gun. Then there are blood films, which result from contact with a substantial quantity of wet blood, causing it to flow over a surface in a continuous layer. There are several chemicals that are used to help locate blood at crime scenes and other places of potential significance, such as the houses and vehicles of suspects, on their clothing, and on anything that might have been used for a weapon. What all these chemicals have in common is that they exist in two different states, one colourless and the other brightly coloured. Transition from the former to the latter occurs in the presence of blood, or rather in the presence of the oxygen that is released when blood reacts with hydrogen peroxide, or bleach, which is also included in the test. A positive reaction to a chemical test for blood is therefore usually indicated by a change in the colour of the reagent, which may be from colourless to pink or blue-green, depending on which test is used. For the test that involves the use of the chemical luminol, however, a positive reaction is indicated not by a colour change, but by chemiluminescence. In other words, it causes the blood to glow in the dark. This can also give some indication of the size, shape, and density of stains and their distribution, which are important for working out how they were formed and therefore what activities might have taken place to produce them. Although luminol is extremely sensitive, it is presumptive only, like the colour tests, and therefore requires follow-up with a confirmatory test. It does, however, have the disadvantage of having to be performed entirely in the dark, which is one of the reasons why it fell out of favour when colour change tests were developed in the mid-1900s. It has been reintroduced in recent years, but only in specific circumstances, such as where it is suspected that a clean-up has been attempted, and to detect blood on difficult surfaces, such as drag marks, or the details of a bloody shoe print on a dark-coloured, heavily patterned carpet. I first used luminol myself in 1989, when I was asked to provide a second opinion in an Italian murder case in which the results of luminol tests were being used as part of the prosecution's case against a defendant called Massimo Carlotto. In January 1976, Carlotto was a student in Padua, northern Italy, when he claimed to have been passing a building and heard someone crying out for help. His sister had a flat on the ground floor of the building, but it was away at the time. So finding the door to the street unlocked, he went to the upstairs flat where the voice seemed to be coming from. On the floor of a built-in wardrobe, he found a young woman lying naked and covered in blood. Bending down on her left side, he was reaching across her body towards her face when she raised her right arm, then let it fall to the floor and closed her eyes. Thinking she was dead, Carlotto ran out of the flat and to the house of some friends who advised him to report what had happened to the police. But as soon as he had done so, he was arrested and charged with the murder of 25-year-old Margherita Magello. In 1978, after spending 2 years in detention, Carlotto was tried for murder, but acquitted due to lack of evidence. The following year, the Italian Ministry of Justice began appeal proceedings to try to have the original verdict overturned. And when the case was heard by the appeal court in Venice, Carlotto was found guilty of murder and sentenced to 18 years in prison. In fact, though, for reasons that aren't totally clear, he ended up living for a while in Mexico, before being expelled from there in 1985, when he returned to Italy and was imprisoned. It was when the Italian Supreme Court ordered a retrial in 1989 that I became involved in the case, and that's when I taught myself how to use the luminol test, which was regarded as being very old-fashioned and wasn't used in UK forensics at all at that time. In order to be able to photograph the reaction of luminol in the dark, you had to set up a camera on a tripod, then position and focus it over the item so that you were ready to take a series of photographs as soon as you sprayed the chemical in the dark. Because the exposure time is so long, you then had to keep the camera very steady as the luminol fluoresced, particularly because having to repeat the process and spray the item again, possibly several times, risks the blood becoming more diffuse and starting to dissolve in the solution. Part of the reason I had to experiment and do lots of practice with luminol for the Carlotto case was because the pathologist involved in the case had said that Carlotto's clothes were plastered in blood, and that once blood dries on an item, it is absolutely fixed on it and never flakes off. In other words, the pattern and extent of blood staining on the items would reflect what they were like at the time of the incident. But in fact, that isn't true. Blood powders as it dries, producing the little puffs of blood dust mentioned earlier when it is handled, the particles of which then settle and resettle well beyond the boundaries of the original blood stain. Over the years, the clothes had been taken in and out of their bags and handled extensively on several occasions, providing lots of opportunity for the blood to become dispersed across them in this way and appear much more extensive than it had originally been. So when you then use luminol, anything can look as though it's plastered in blood. I think the pathologist was getting confused by the fact that in blood grouping, the older the blood is, the more difficult it is to get it into solution so that you can then group it, particularly from some types of fabric. To illustrate the point, some of my experiments involved putting a small amount of blood on an item, then repeatedly putting the item in a bag and getting it out again, and showing how much more extensive the blood on it was at the end of the process than at the beginning. So I was also able to show that because of its extreme sensitivity, combined with the way in which the items in the case had been handled over the years, the luminol results in this instance had given a completely misleading impression of the extent of bloodstaining on Carlotto's clothing. I believed that this bloodstaining was actually entirely consistent with his own account of events and did not indicate, as suggested by the prosecution, that he had played any active role in attacking the victim. Unfortunately, due to the fact that the Italian legal code in force at the time apparently provided grounds for exclusion, neither I nor the French forensic scientist who also attended the trial was allowed to give evidence in the court in Venice, and Massimo Carlotto was convicted. But 3 years later, following an international campaign for justice, he was pardoned by the President of Italy and went on to be a successful crime writer. It was a trail of blood that helped to identify one of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.